Hi, my name is Sharon Chen. This video is about diagnosis of tuberculosis infection and disease. The learning objectives are to distinguish latent tuberculosis infection, or LTBI, from active TB disease through clinical and laboratory findings, to describe how TST and IGRA function to diagnose TB infection, to describe how TSTs are placed and interpreted, to explain why IGRAs can distinguish between infection with MTB versus vaccination with BCG, to list some of the differences between TST and IGRAs and recognize their limitations in diagnosing TB infection and disease, and to articulate the value of MTB culture in the diagnosis of TB disease. I want to first give you a historical perspective about TB diagnosis. First of all, clinical diagnosis of latent TB infection is impossible. Remember that the person is asymptomatic. In 1882, Koch was able to identify MTB as a causative agent of tuberculosis, and the next obvious step was to find a cure. In August of 1890, Koch made a sensational announcement of a remedy against TB disease at the 10th International Medical Congress in Berlin. It was called tuberculin, and you can see a vial of it in the photo. This turned out to be a terrible mistake. Tuberculin was a preparation of dead bacilli that elicited a necrotizing response in granulomas, but did not sterilize tissue. It was later that the tuberculin reaction was noted to be a useful way to detect latent TB infection. Diagnosis of latent TB infection and active TB disease is different. Diagnosis of active TB disease is based on clinical signs and symptoms and diagnostic testing. Diagnosis of latent TB infection is more difficult. There are no clinical signs and symptoms. Diagnosis is then based on considerations of the level of exposure and the risk of progressing to TB disease. Diagnostic tests that are used include the tuberculin skin test, TST, interferon gamma release assay, IGRA, and culture of MTB from body fluids and tissues. In the next slide, I'm going to give you details that can help you diagnose latent TB infection versus active TB disease, because it can be very difficult. Let's start with latent TB infection. The point here is that we are looking for evidence of TB infection without evidence of TB disease. You should look for the following. Ask about exposure to MTB and specifically consider the duration, frequency, and proximity to evaluate the risk. Make sure there are no signs or symptoms of active TB disease. If you have suspicion of TB exposure, you can do a TB test, either a TST or IGRA. For latent TB infection, these should be positive. If the TB test is positive, obtain a chest radiograph, which is normal or shows evidence of an old inactive calcified nodule. You can see this calcified nodule in the top chest image. The red arrow points to it. This person does not have active TB disease. We look for the following things to diagnose active TB disease. All of them may not be present in a person with disease. Again, you should ask about exposure to MTB. In TB disease, the person does have clinical signs and symptoms of pulmonary and possibly extrapulmonary disease. The TST or IGRA should be positive. The chest X-ray in this case is abnormal. In the bottom chest image, you can see a cavity in the left upper lobe apex region. The red arrow and red dot point to it. In addition, you can obtain AFB stains on sputum or tissue, which may show MTB bacilli. You should also obtain culture of sputum, body fluids, or tissue, which may grow MTB. Molecular assays such as PCR can also be done that can detect MTB in these specimens. I'm going to now tell you how the tuberculin skin test works to help diagnose latent TB infection. In the U.S., the tuberculin preparation we use is called PPD, or purified protein derivative, so sometimes you will hear this test called a PPD test. PPD is essentially a preparation of dead MTB bacilli. PPD is placed intradermally into the forearm with a tuberculin syringe to produce a raised bump of tuberculin. This initial raised bump will disappear. I hope you can see from the slide that placing a TST is tricky, and inappropriate application can affect interpretation of this test. The principle of TST is to detect the memory T cell response to MTB antigens. Injection of PPD, that is the MTB antigens, in the skin is picked up by dendritic cells patrolling the skin. The dendritic cells migrate to a local lymph node, presenting the MTB antigens to an MTB-specific memory T cell. This activates the memory T cell, which then migrates to the injection site and releases pro-inflammatory cytokines like TNF-alpha and interferon gamma to kill MTB. The red bump response is a result of these pro-inflammatory cytokines, and this response takes 48 to 72 hours to appear. Interpretation of TST is based on two factors. First is the measurement. This is reported in millimeters of the diameter of the amount of induration, or the bump, not the redness. There are three breakpoints at 5, 10, and 15 millimeters. The second factor is the risk of progression to active TB disease. The higher the risk of progression to active TB disease, the lower the measurement cutoff is for interpreting TST as a positive test. For example, as you can see in the table, if a patient has HIV, she is at very high risk of progressing to TB disease, so her cutoff is set at greater or equal to 5 millimeters for interpreting TST as a positive test. In contrast, in someone with no risk factors, the cutoff is at 15 millimeters. There are many challenges to interpreting the TST. False negative results can occur, so perhaps think about what could make this happen. One possibility that I've already mentioned is from incorrectly placing the TST. Now recall how this test works. It measures the memory T cell response, so people who don't have a normal immune system can have a false negative result. If you do this test early in TB infection before the latent period, the test may be falsely negative because the T cell response to MTB has not yet developed. Finally, false negatives can also occur in very severe or disseminated TB disease. The reason for this is not clear, but likely has to do with a compromised adaptive immune response. False positives can also occur because of cross-reactivity of the TB antigens used in TST to other mycobacteria, including non-tuberculosis mycobacteria and even the mycobacteria strain used as a vaccine called BCG. Because of these challenges, a new diagnostic test has been developed recently. It is called the interferon gamma release assay, or IGRA. Similar to TST, IGRAs detect a memory MTB-specific T cell response. In this case, it is a blood test instead of a skin test, and it measures the actual amount of one of the pro-inflammatory cytokines, interferon gamma, instead of measuring the induration caused by all of the pro-inflammatory cytokines. The TB antigens used to elicit the memory T cell response in the IGRA are very specific, not the undefined mixture contained in PPD. These specific TB antigens were chosen to reduce the false positive TST results from BCG vaccine and from environmental non-tuberculosis mycobacteria. The fact that we can choose specific TB antigens means that there are important differences between pathogenic and non-pathogenic mycobacteria. BCG vaccine is composed of an attenuated Mycobacterium bovis isolate. When people were trying to figure out why this M. bovis isolate was attenuated, they compared its genome to the parental virulent M. bovis and to M. tuberculosis. They found several regions of the genome that were lost in the attenuated M. bovis BCG isolate. One region, called RD1, contains the genes for a secretion system and its secreted effector proteins that are important for granuloma formation. IGRAs use peptides from these two MTB proteins. There are some differences between TST and IGRA, and the table shows you advantages and disadvantages of each. One test is not necessarily better than the other. There are also limitations of both TST and IGRA. These tests are an indirect measurement of MTB infection. It is measuring the immune response, not the presence of microbes. It cannot identify early or primary MTB infection before T cell responses have been activated, which you will recall takes about 3 to 9 weeks. It cannot distinguish between latent TB infection and active TB disease. It also cannot predict risk of progression to TB disease. So how do we definitively diagnose active TB disease? The gold standard is culture. And this is the only way to show definitive infection and the only way to obtain drug susceptibility. So I want you to remember that when you are diagnosing active TB disease, you need to obtain cultures. But growth in cultures is very slow and takes 4 to 6 weeks. Here's a close-up picture of MTB colonies growing on an auger after many weeks of incubation. Sputum smear positive for AFB stain can provide early indication of active TB disease, but not all patients have this. Tissue sampling from tissue biopsies, lumbar puncture, and urine culture are important for diagnosing extrapulmonary disease. PCR amplification and sequencing techniques have improved speed, sensitivity of identification, and give quicker drug susceptibility results. Molecular tests are increasingly important for developing countries to decrease TB transmission.